Welcome to the Communication Roundtable series. Thanks for coming. Today our roundtable will focus on political campaigning in the digital age. First, I will briefly introduce our distinguished panel of experts here, and then request them to speak a few words on the role of digital media in political campaigns. And after that, we will move on to question and answer session. On my left, we have Dr. Alan Rosenblatt. Dr. Rosenblatt is the Associate Director of Online Advocacy and the Social Media Strategist for the Center for American Progress and CAP Action Fund. He created and hosts the Internet Advocacy Roundtable, teaches digital political strategy at Johns Hopkins, Georgetown, and American universities, blogs at the Huffington Post, techpresident.com, and K Street Cafe, serves on edemocracy.org's board of directors, and was a 2008 fellow at George Washington University's Institute for Politics, Democracy, and the Internet. He taught the world's first internet politics course at George Mason University in 1995. Dr. Rosenblatt has a PhD in political science from American University. You can also find him on Twitter at Dr. DigiPoll, at Progress League, and at CAP Action. Then we have Mr. Michael Bassik. Mr. Bassik is the Managing Director and U.S. Digital Practice Chair at Burson-Marsteller, a leading global public relations and communications firm. He is an accomplished digital strategist with more than 11 years of experience. He has built several successful online political and public affairs practices and has been honored for his industry-leading work by Yahoo, the American Association of Political Consultants, and Politico. He has worked with several high-profile clients, including IBM, Ford, Coca-Cola, the Democratic National Committee, John Kerry for president, and Hillary Clinton for president. Then we have Ms. Katie Herbert. Ms. Katie Herbert is the Associate Manager for Policy at Facebook, where she focuses on political outreach. Prior to Facebook, Ms. Herbert was the Chief Digital Strategist at the National Republican Senatorial Committee. She previously led digital strategy in positions at DCI Group, the Rudy Giuliani for President campaign, and the Republican National Committee. She holds a BA in Journalism and Political Science from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Then we have Mr. Josh Koster. Mr. Koster is the managing partner of Chong plus Koster, a communications agency that specializes in high-profile clients. He has advised campaigns, Fortune 500 companies, and even foreign governments. He is credited with coining the term nano-targeting, proving that online ads can move public opinion, and winning the first statewide election using online ads as the primary form of voter communication. In addition to his digital work, he has written and analyzed polls and has raised millions of dollars for Democratic candidates and causes. Then we have Mr. Patrick Ruffini. Mr. Patrick Ruffini is a co-founder and partner at Engage, a digital agency that provides political organizations, causes, and brands with innovative tools to inspire action everywhere, online and off. Prior to starting the company in 2007, Mr. Ruffini led digital efforts for the Republican National Committee and served as part of the pioneering digital team at Bush Cheney 04 campaign, which used the internet to recruit 1.4 million volunteers and execute a winning ground game. Mr. Ruffini was named as a 2011 Tech Titan by Washingtonian Magazine for his leadership in the DC technology community and a rising star in American politics by Campaigns Elections Magazine in 2008. So now I'll request the panelists to speak a few words about the role of digital media in political campaigns. I would first request Dr. Alan Rosenblatt to address the audience.
Great. Thanks for having me here. It's good to be here. I'm not going to go into a lot of the details that I think my colleagues will go into on the general things, but I want to talk a little bit about using social media in the context of events, and I want to thank my interns who are here who help put together some of the research for this. But I recently attended the tweet up at the White House where the president was tweeting, and I've been talking with a few congressional staff, new media staff, about how to do social media integrated into events, as well as trying to integrate them at our events at CAP. And I think there's an interesting opportunity here, especially as we look forward to the campaign trail, because while those examples, the tweet up at the White House and things, are very state event, I think you're going to find that as candidates are moving out into the field and doing events at you know, fundraising events or town halls or meetings across the country, the opportunity to get social media to sort of enhance that event is going to be really important. The thing to remember is that whether or not they do it, whether or not they ask people to do it themselves or organize how it's going to be done, people in the audience are going to be using Twitter and are going to be using, if they have mobile Facebook applications, they're going to be reporting on what they see at the events anyway. So I think the important thing is, given that context, that the members, the candidates are going to have to sort of take the reins and try to steer it so that it's they get the maximum value out of it. Just a basic model, and then I'll wait for questions and answer to talk about other things. The way I look at it is, you know, when you have a live event and you're streaming it on video or it's on television, there's a lot more people who want to be participating in that event than those who are just in the audience at the spot on that at that moment. And so the fact that the video is being distributed gives an opportunity for a lot more people to see it, but traditionally there's no way to interact, no way to ask questions, no way to comment on it. And what we've seen recently in the last few years, and I should say that Michael, who's sitting next to me, was famous at South by Southwest for a couple years ago for an example of this. People in the audience start to talk about what's happening in the event in front of them and may actually sometimes hijack the event. Michael was part of a group of people that hijacked an interview of Mark Zuckerberg at South by Southwest when the reporter was throwing him softballs when he should have been talking about Beacon. Mm-hmm. Is that the case? Yeah. and he forced the situation to change. Now, a candidate needs to be kind of out in front of that and to get people live tweeting. So the way I look at it is there's sort of three phases. There's before the event, there's during the event, and then there's after the event. Before the event, you should be pushing out, you know, this event is happening. We're going to be using this hashtag so that you can get your comments aggregated and we can monitor them. You can submit questions in advance or during the event. And then as you go through that, you're literally promoting the event to a large audience and not just the local audience. Those local events, perhaps at primaries, in primary campaigns, you know, contests locally, end up becoming national events. And especially since there are almost always multiple primaries going on at the same time, that is a big boon to being able to reach a larger audience. During the event, you want to make sure that everybody, again, is alerted to what the hashtag is, not just the people who are on Twitter or watching on video, but the people in the audience as well, so that there's that common hashtag to gather and aggregate all the conversations together. And then you should probably have a staff person live tweeting it to make sure that at least something going out there is a steady flow that represents the candidate's campaign position and messaging. And then, you know, to the extent to which candidates want to actually get their hands dirty on Twitter in the process, I like the idea of, you know, the questions come in, they get offered, the candidate would actually retweet it, and then and then they would answer very quickly on Twitter and then kind of turn to the audience in the camera and extend the reactions a little bit while the staff continues to live tweet what they're saying and then move on to the next question and repeat the process. After the events are over, it's really important to make sure that you continue to promote the event, recount what happened, perhaps if there's an event archive video to make sure that that's distributed quite widely. But also, this is the opportunity for the staff to then sit down and systematically start following everybody who retweeted or tweeted about the event and start to thank them for their participation and identify potential volunteers, both offline volunteers and online volunteers, because there's nothing like getting an audience of people who really care about the candidate, who really support the candidate on Twitter, on Facebook, to be able to share the materials that are and the messages that are coming out of the campaign out to their trusted networks. And so that's kind of the basic model. We'll see how well it's implemented. We'll see who, if anybody implements it in that particular rendition, if somebody comes up with something a little more interesting in the process. I certainly don't think that that's the limit to how we would approach it, but that's my current thinking on kind of a best practice on how to do an event that's integrating social media with live video and live audiences.
Thank you.
Such as this event.
Such as this event.
Thank you. I should also announce that we are live tweeting, and we have a student, Kate Merriweather. She's helping us tweet this event live, and the hashtag is JHUSOC. So if you want to follow us on Twitter, you can follow that hashtag. And now I would request Mr. Bassik to tell our audience a little bit about your perspective on how digital media should be used in political
campaigns. Sure. I think my perspective is a little skewed because I don't think I've ever been in a panel where there's alcohol. So I thought you're allowed to get up to get more alcohol, but then you have to bring the bottle and refill the panelists' glasses. So. I want to take you back. Alan sort of started it in 1995 in his biography, and that's when it was called Digipolitics.
Cyberpolitics.
Yes, I think 99 was cyberpolitics. I'm declaring 99 cyberpolitics. Okay. I want to take you back to 99. I told you I would do it, but then I told you I wouldn't do it. So Patrick and I have been sharing panels on politics since 1999, 2000, because at the University of Pennsylvania, I was the head of students for Gore, and Patrick was the head of students for Bush. And we set up on the storied Locust Walk that goes through the Penn campus on opposite sides of each other. And you can imagine liberal arts school, Philadelphia, you know, where was the bigger line? Where was the larger line? Where were people like excited and energetic? And of course, it was at my booth, and I always sort of held that over him. And now, to see, and I'm just kidding, of course, but we've shared the panel. It's great to be here with you, and thank you to John Topkins and Alan.
We come to blows, don't be surprised.
Yeah, we've fought a few times, it's okay. But I sort of want to take you back there because there's something happening this election cycle that's worth mentioning for its lack of excitement. So I want to take you back to 2000. 2000 election cycle. Was sort of the first election cycle that politics and the internet started to be mentioned in the same sentence. And the media was all excited about cyber politics and that candidates started to have websites. And that was really the extent of what you could do online, is you could have a website. That was it. And we were, because this was before social media, before video, before we really had a lot of tools at our disposal, we would advertise on the internet. That was sort of our way of using the internet as a communications tool, advertising, website. And I remember my senior year, or was junior or senior, when I got an email from Al Gore, and I was like convinced that he wrote it. I was like, Al Gore wrote this email. I remember I was in the student lounge, and I was sitting there. It was like those little cool, weirdly shaped Mac monitors. Remember those before they were like sleek and flat? They were like weird and egg-shaped. And I was like, this is amazing. And it was like, Dear Michael. And like that was sort of where it started, where they started with personalized email, they started with websites, and they started with advertising. And over the last few election cycles, we've seen advertising take a back seat to some of the what I would call the free tools. Not free because you have to pay us to help you with them, but social media emerged and really saw last election cycle, the last presidential election cycle, sort of a breakthrough phenomena where individuals were all of a sudden really empowered to have a role in a political campaign. Different than in the beginning of like the Howard Dean campaign where people were able to like comment on a blog. This was real empowerment. And now you're seeing a transition back to paid media. And this election cycle, the FEC analysis just came out. I think our friend KK at ClickZ identified that the Obama campaign / DNC has already spent $1 million advertising online this election cycle. And that's clearly a record to be spending that much money online this early. It's probably still not enough. And the truth is you probably haven't even seen any of the ads. A lot of them are search engine marketing advertisements. But the point that they're already spending that much is a real fantastic development for us in our industry, where we've seen this sort of transition over 10 years from have a website, don't want to spend any money online, to finally realizing that the internet is an important persuasive medium. But I think the one thing I want to stress and point out about this election cycle that I think is different is a little depressing for me, in that we used to feel like we were these rabble-rousers, that we were these young, brash, emphatic group of people who were sitting at the table at a political campaign, if we were even invited to the table, saying, you have to be looking at the internet, you have to be using social media, you have to be advertising online, you have to be doing this with your website, you have to be writing these types of emails. And, you know, people listen, they pay us lip service. I worked on elections even in the last most recent election cycle. We're still, the campaign managers were like, yeah, nice study. Nice case study, nice research, but you get 1% of the media budget. Even though, like, you know, I have a proverbial seat at the table. And I think what's happening this cycle that's different is that's no longer the case. And I'm a little upset about that, but we're kind of the establishment now. We're no longer the rabble-rouser. We're no longer those, like, crazy kids talking about the internet in the back of the room. You know, we're part of the, we're at the table, and I think it comes with a new responsibility. Whereas in the past, we used to be able to really have fun and experiment, and like, no one's gonna see it anyway, so let's go advertise there, or let's go try that thing, or sure, go build that app. And I think now we're held to a different standard. We're held to a different standard of accountability. We're held to a different standard of professionalization. And we have to be at the table. You got to dress like the people at the table. You got to talk like the people at the table. You got to be able to interpret a poll. You have to be able to provide commentary and insight into other areas, other strategies of the campaign. So I think this is a seismic shift to establishment, which is ultimately a really good thing, but a personally depressing thing.
To address our audience on the role of digital media in political campaigns.
Kind of going off of what Michael said, I really think too that I almost see it as we've somewhat taken a step back, and I think campaigns have gotten a little too excited with the shiny tools. They need to take a step back and look at it in terms of you need to be engaging with folks online, you need to be authentic, and this isn't easy. Way too many campaigns are looking for the silver bullet of what's going to be the thing that raises me $5 million in one day. And then we're just going to keep repeating that every single day, right? Because we'll keep raising $5 million. And I think we've seen campaigns too much focus on how many Twitter followers do I have? How many Facebook likes do I have? How many donors do I have? How many people are on my email list? And activists have become numbers to them and not people. And where I think we need to go back to is a place where campaigns, having the number of likes you have on your Facebook page is important, but those people could be from Indonesia for all you know. They might not be voters. And
where Barack Obama was born.
That's true. Yeah. I heard that. But if you have, I think, you know, the more that you can get people where it's actually the candidate doing some of this themselves. At the senatorial committee, I had a seat at the table. I was senior staff. And a big reason for that and a big reason I was able to do a lot, it wasn't anywhere near what a lot of the Democrats get to do online, but a reason I was able to get to do a lot is John Cornyn tweets himself, he's on Facebook himself, he brings out his iPad, he's sharing news articles, so he understands how the platforms work and was therefore able to give me the sort of leeway that I needed to do what I thought we should do online, which one of the things I found was we raise more money by not asking for it. The biggest thing that drives me nuts about the Republican presidential campaigns is that every single email I get is asking for money. And in the case of some, we've gone back to memo format, which who writes an email in memo format anymore? So, but it's, you know, we've just taken a huge step back from where we once were. Even last cycle in 2010, when you look at folks like Marco Rubio and Pat Toomey, who really won their elections where, you know, 18 months before the election, nobody gave them a chance of winning. And they had to use social media to really interact with folks, do live streams, do those things that were rabble-rousing, that as, you know, a front-runner candidate, you can't necessarily do. So the big things I stress to campaigns is that Facebook, Twitter, anything online, it's only a tool. The messaging is really important. And I think the Obama campaign has it right, because every message you hear out of them is that you own this campaign. It's about you. We want to hear what you think. We need your help. things of that nature. And you don't hear that from the Republicans as much. It's more, here's what I think. I'm going to push it out over all these social media tools. Hey, don't I look cool? I'm using these. And I think the messaging needs to change a little bit so that you are legitimately engaging with folks. Because you may have only a third of the fans of another candidate, but if you have more people engaging on your posts, more people are probably seeing those posts, wanting to vote for you. And if they're in Iowa and New Hampshire, it could make the difference of winning or not. And then I think more candidates need to be interested in it, wanting to do it themselves. Because if they're pushing on the campaign manager and the media buyers to be using the web more, those consultants are eventually going to have to do it. And then just finally, it is a lot of hard work. It takes a lot of testing of different landing pages, of different buttons. I mean, the color of a button can make a difference. And I think that way too many campaigns just want to put a page up there and not really analyze the data that they're getting from it. And they're really missing a huge pie of people that they can be getting those email addresses from that can eventually turn into donors.
Thank you. Yes, Mr. Koster, can you give it?
Sure. So I'd like to build a little bit on what Michael said and also tell a little story about him that not many people, I think, he's certainly too humble to claim. But he's basically the guy.
Speak louder if you're talking about me.
Bassik's basically the father of online political advertising. He's, to my knowledge, he ran the first online ad for a political campaign, right? The first serious one. You were the first out there trying, like, showing studies, measuring this, trying to do any of the, you know, credibility building around online paid media. And so when the note he made that for the first time in a decade now of online political campaigning, that this medium is being taken very, very seriously is something that's been a long time coming. And we're now at a point with political campaigns where I think the internet has become relevant to all political campaigns, whereas it used to be, you know, in the Howard Dean grow your email list, get people to comment on blogs model, you know, it worked if you were Howard Dean or maybe, you know, Ron Paul or maybe Barack Obama. But it becomes harder and harder and harder when you start running for races like dog catcher or state legislature, which might as well be dog catcher as far as most voters are concerned. And, you know, those are most of the races in the country, that and ballot initiatives and, you know, AG races and city council races and mayorals. And, you know, for most of those races, it's quite hard to get people to come out of nowhere and be inspired for a seat they didn't even know was elected half the time. And certainly to get them to organize or do anything serious for y'all is just sort of, to some extent, a pipe dream. Now, what's big about the online advertising side of it is that online ads can connect with pretty much everybody now. Basically, all adults in America are on the internet. It's something like 4 in 5 voters use the internet regularly. Something like 1 in 3 can't be reached through TV straight up at all anymore in the weeks leading up to an election. And that's largely through fast-forwarding and TiVo, not people who are just watching Hulu, for instance. And it's now the case that online is really the only broadcast medium you can buy to purchase communications with most of your voters in most districts. It now has a deeper, greater, wider penetration with greater frequency than broadcast TV does. You can now serve online political ads, online TV ads to almost as large of an audience online as you can to cable, through cable. You can't get quite the same frequency with all of them, but you know the reaches are starting to get there. And if you look at it, like Google has an 80% reach. Many of these top ad networks alone have a larger penetration than, you know, ABC had back when it was ABC, NBC, CBS. So there's quite a lot to be said for, you know, what's going to be happening online with political campaigns, but I think that what's important is to look at what will be happening down in the dog catcher race, because that's going to determine how things are being won all the way up and down the ballot. What works down the ballot, what works for dog catcher, will work up the ballot. It always has. But what works for president usually never works for anything but president.
Thank you. Now I would request Mr. Ruffini to speak a few words about the role of digital media in political campaigns.
Thank you. I think Josh touches on an important point. Every race is different, and every race, you know, what works in one will not necessarily work in the other. But I think what's been true at, for a while, and it's not new, at the presidential level, that digital media, I think, truly is the central nervous system of a campaign, that without digital, these campaigns could not function the way they do. And this was true all the way back in 04 when I sort of got my start in digital politics at the, you know, working for the Bush campaign. And when I first got to the Bush campaign, within 2 weeks, I was a junior level staffer. My title was webmaster. I worked in the communications department. And, you know, we were buried deep within the campaign, one of two people doing the website out of an organization that even very early on had over 100. And we were juggling all these different tasks. We weren't just working on communication stuff. We were working on stuff for political. We were sending fundraising emails. And we all of a sudden realized, wait, we're kind of the hub here. And that manifested in small ways sometimes. So when somebody wanted a logo, you know, I'd be usually the guy who got it for them. Or if they wanted like a, you know, Missouri for Bush sign for a podium or something, because I knew how to work Photoshop, you know, I'm the guy who gives it to them. And very quickly early on, I mean, I think the thing in communications didn't last very long, that eventually they realized, wait, we do need a senior staff position. We do need somebody who can integrate all of these tools across the different channels of the campaign and across the three different things that a campaign needs to do, which is communicate with voters, which is to raise money, and which is to mobilize volunteers for the final push and to get out the vote. And I think in each of these areas, if you, as a digital strategist, even at the low level, aren't thinking in terms of how are you serving those three major macro goals of the campaign, if you're doing something because it's cool, or for its own sake, or it doesn't reach that many people, you're probably not going to be that successful. You'll probably get a good hit off of it. Like, you might get a great Mashable story about this niche social network that you just integrated yourself with. And that's good from a sometimes that stuff is good from a communications perspective, but it's not ultimately at the end of the day what's going to win votes. The way things this has evolved, I mean, I think in importance, I mean, the first dawn of the internet was in a political campaign, I think, would have to be John McCain after winning the New Hampshire primary in 2000, getting $2 million within 48 hours online, and people kind of awakening to the fact that you can use the internet as an insurgent medium. He was then not the front runner, and you can use it as an insurgent medium to combat sort of the front runner, the guy who's supposed to win, and you can use it to effectively play catch up. Howard Dean also benefited from this trend in 04. Fast forward though to 2008, and you know, John McCain's a complete noob when it comes to online politics. I mean, doesn't use a BlackBerry, doesn't really get it. And that was the narrative of that campaign. He was the same guy who ran for president 8 years ago. Why does one guy raise millions of dollars overnight, and why does another guy just sort of get sort of stuck in the online doldrums? And it's ultimately about you know, it being an insurgent medium and a medium that benefits people who are coming from behind and trying to capture that mantle. But even in the 04 election, you know, when I was involved, I think people were always surprised at how big the impact was once you open the gate. Typically, campaigns are a pretty insular affair. I mean, you spend a few million dollars, you put it on TV, there's a staff on a statewide campaign of maybe 10 or 20 people at most. You know, it's not that big. And when you open it up to all the latent energy and latent activity of people just wanting to do stuff for you on the outside, and all the online activists that are out there just wanting to do things, it grows to be, inherently speaking, a lot bigger than those core 20 people sitting in an office somewhere, even at a lower level race. And your task is to kind of create a permission structure for those people to act independently of the campaign and to do stuff to magnify that campaign, whether it's sharing up stuff on Facebook, whether it's giving money online, whether it's doing all those things that will ultimately lead to victory. But even in 04, like, the results kind of spoke for themselves, that Kerry raised half of his money online, and that's what he used to compete financially with Bush in an election where everybody kind of thought, you know, he'd get financially blown out of the water. Now, you know, we haven't addressed maybe the other part of what that question is, what are you putting on TV? And what's the quality of that messaging, which I think probably many Democrats would say was lacking. But at the same time, it was an enormous shift and an eye-opener, I think, for traditional campaign political types. One of the kind of untold stories is we, on the Bush campaign, we were probably the last major political campaign in history that didn't care about raising money online, because we had plenty of it, and we weren't going to, we were going to be staying within public financing for the general election. That's, of course, kind of out the window now. And we decided we're going to use this to mobilize volunteers. We got 70% of our volunteers through the internet and executed a ground game, built online tools that allowed people to walk their precinct, call voters, and write letters to people in swing states who shared a certain demographic characteristic with them. Maybe they were a doctor. Maybe they were something else. Fast forward to 2008, and all these trends that coalesced on force supersized. And you see Barack Obama raising $500 million online. You see people raising $10 million online in the space of a weekend. You see people organizing, using social networks to organize in far-flung states that the campaign wouldn't necessarily be able to organize. All these things getting to be more and more of actual game changers. And the question for campaigns is, how do we take, I guess, all of this activity that's out there, that's latent, and really change the way we do business to accommodate, rather than, you know, how do we get the internet to do our bidding for us? How do we better do the internet's bidding in order to win?
Thank you. I think that was really informative. We got a really diverse perspective. I mean, we got a historical background.
Can't hear us?
Oh, okay. Can you hear me now? Okay. I was just saying that we got a very diverse perspective on how digital media has been used in political campaigns traditionally, like, you know, when it started way back, and now, you know. So I think it would be interesting to know, what do you really think is going to change in the coming elections? What are some of the prominent, you know, new things that are going to come up in the upcoming elections?
Well, everybody kind of talked about 08 being kind of the social media election, but it really wasn't, because it was still in its infancy. I mean, Obama used maybe Facebook Connect in the last 2 weeks of the campaign. Now it's on every website. So I think it's going to be the election where people are going to experiment a lot on social media. It's going to be the place where, you know, people are going to be experimenting ways to do kind of mass voter outreach through trying to get into the news feed of the newsfeed of their activists that will then go to 500 more people and trying to amplify their message. So I think social media, and number two, I think data, that we're sitting literally on the internet on an accumulating mountain and pile of data, and what do we do with it? But based on consumer databases, based on voter files, based on web analytics logs, and the whole big data movement to try and better predict sort of behaviors from that store of data that's been built up, is not necessarily something that's going to be visible, but I think it's going to matter in this campaign.
The only thing I would add is mobile. Pew came out with a study last week that showed a large chunk, not a majority yet, but a large chunk of people mostly access the internet every day on their smartphones. And the amount of mobile traffic politically is growing very, very rapidly, where I think it could double or triple from where it is today. And so more campaigns that are even just the basics of having a mobile site, allowing mobile sharing on social networks, making their emails friendly to read on a mobile site, I think will be huge. But then also, too, how are those phones used at rallies to help gather donations? How, you know, like Alan was talking about, location-based stuff and people tweeting during events and actually live reporting, you know, posting pictures on Facebook. How are those things going to start changing elections? Because more and more Americans are getting their news from friends and family rather than necessarily watching the evening news.
I'd like to add one piece to the data part. In addition to the collection of data that's being used for online targeting and for online profiling, and I couldn't agree more. I have data circled right here. I think that the accumulation of this data is where, frankly, a massive amount of the return on investment people see, the value campaigns see, will be coming from. But to build to that, we just at the end of the last cycle started to see campaigns starting to use digital data to inform non-digital decision making. And by that I mean I've now got clients who test billboards as online ads first, and clients who run TV ads online before they ever go on TV and before the buys are even planned on TV, just to figure out, you know, which ones get skipped more, who is responding well to this, because there's just simply interaction data that is now available to anyone who runs these ads that you couldn't pay for before. You'd have to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars in market research to even approximate some of these things that are coming in. And so we're beginning to see, particularly, it's happening more and more down the ballot, because up the ballot, they're still being able to, they can still afford, you know, real extensive, deep market research. But on the races where, you know, it was a one-poll race or a no-poll race or a two-poll race, which is, you know, more, like 90% of races or more, we're really starting to see online techniques and tools and this treasure trove of data starting to get tapped to make offline decisions in the first place.
So I just want to push even further on the social media stuff, because I think it's true. All the candidates are going to be out there using social media, figuring out new ways to push their message out further. But the truth is that social media is about interacting not just with your audience, but taking advantage of the fact that your audience is interacting with each other simultaneously. And so we're going to see some races, and it's not going to be universal across the country, but I think we're going to see some races where some candidates are really going to separate themselves from the pack by using social media, not just to get their message out, but to truly engage with voters. And we've gone through several decades in this country where voters increasingly feel like they have no connection to government, where government is not responsive to people generally, nor to them individually. And these tools provide an opportunity to change that narrative, to change that sense. And there are going to be some candidates that truly break through the mentality of, I'm speaking to the voters, and say, I'm speaking with the voters.
Intern Elizabeth walked in after I gave my opening before, so I'm going to give my opening again, if that's okay. Hey. I didn't even know she was going to be here. You know how exciting that is? That's so exciting. I think the biggest change or the biggest trend is, again, I'm going to be the guy who talks about advertising, and I wasn't going to be, but I'm so happy I don't have to be the guy to talk about mobile. This is going to be the first election cycle where 10% of media budgets from the presidential candidates are going to be spent online. I mean, the internet used to be the last bastion of silence when it came to advertising. I mean, if you were in a targeted election district or a swing state, you could not avoid political communication 6 weeks before election day on television. It was every commercial, radio, every commercial, billboards, yard signs, direct mail. But unless you were very engaged in the political cycle, you really didn't get a lot of political communication. I have a lot of friends who their only touch point on political was online was probably some kind of like really nasty email chain letter that I spent like 4 hours disproving. But that's not going to be the case this election cycle. We're not going to be able to get away from online advertising. And I say get away, and I'll talk specifically what I mean by that. But in the last, I'd say, week or so before Election Day in 2008, you saw Barack Obama took over the homepages of websites, local newspaper websites. And if you knew which local newspaper websites to go to, or if someone sent you a link, like, you saw those ads, and they're really fantastic, very nice ads. You're not going to be able to escape them. They're going to be on every website everywhere. So it's going to feel different. You're going to notice a big difference. But the other thing, and I know everyone on the panel is probably, you know, it was a trend probably last election cycle, probably not a trend anymore. But there's something called remarketing. I'm not sure if you're all familiar with it. I used it really brilliantly in a campaign. Thank you. Really brilliantly in a campaign. the last election cycle, Dan Malloy, who's now governor of Connecticut, was being outspent 5-1 in the primary. He was running against Ned Lamont, who, if you remember, won the Democratic primary against Joe Lieberman when he was running for Senate. So we had this billionaire, or at least millionaire candidate, who was completely outspending Dan Malloy online, offline, everywhere. And the campaign said, our biggest struggle right now is that we're talking to the party establishment. We're talking to all the voters in Connecticut, and they're saying, there's no way you're going to be able to compete, Dan Malloy, against Ned Lamont. There's just no way. He has so much more money. So I can't vote for you in the primary, because how are you going to compete against the millionaires in the general election? We came up with an idea to use remarketing, which uses cookies to advertise exclusively to people who have previously visited your website. So I visit your website on Monday, then I'm surfing the web all over the place on Tuesday, and all I see are Dan Malloy ads. And I don't realize that the reason I'm seeing those ads on Tuesday is because I visited your website on Monday. So all of a sudden, all the reporters, all the influentials, all the voters throughout the state are saying, oh my God, Dan Malloy is everywhere. He's totally able to compete. I see his ads all over the place. I'm voting for Dan Malloy. And he won in a landslide because of remarketing. No, I'm kidding. But I think we'll see a lot of that. I think we'll see a lot of targeting using data to target online. I think that's going to be a difference. The ads that you see will be completely different than the ads that you see, not just based on what websites you visit, but what websites your friends visit, based on your gender, age, all of that. We're going to see a lot more targeting online than we have in the past.
Thank you. I wanted to ask Ms. Herbert, you stressed upon the importance of messaging as opposed to tools. So, I mean, you know, anyone who's creating an online campaign, how does one, you know, go through this clutter, stream out the clutter and actually focus on the messaging that they want to? Because, you know, as Dr. Rosenblatt said, like, you know, audience are interacting with each other too. So they are going to, you know, reinforce your message, or they can also, you know, fritter away your message. Like, it may not have that impact that you want to have. So how do you control that online?
Well, I think control is the wrong word. I think it's somewhat more going with the flow. And you need to do some research before you start putting your messaging out. You need to be seeing what people are talking about that messaging already online and try to take that and insert yourself into that conversation rather than, you know, having everybody right now is talking about debt ceiling, but I'm going to put out healthcare messaging. Because no one right now is going to be paying attention to healthcare messaging when all of, you know, what everyone's talking about right now is debt ceiling, economy and jobs. And I think too often campaigns right away are like, here's the messages I want to hit. I'm going to just share those with the audience. And then they're going to engage with me, right? Because I'm asking them to engage with me. But it turns out that they care about this issue over here. And so by using a combination of the online advertising, reading what's happening on Twitter, reading what's happening on Facebook, getting a gauge of where people stand before you start making those decisions can really pay off for you in the end, and can be really an inexpensive way to do your own little focus group before you launch anything. You know, the RNC last cycle, one of its the best online fundraising campaign it did was Fire Nancy Pelosi. And the reason they picked the phrase Fire Nancy Pelosi is they did some Google search ads leading up to that event to figure out what phrasing people clicked on the most. And then they, you know, got things set up so that way the Google bots already, you know, had seen the website. It was showing up in search. They had ads ready for it. They had Facebook ads ready for it. They laid a big foundation in place before it launched, rather than just being like, I think, you know, this phrase is best, and so we're gonna go nuts with that.
So, like, Bush's 2004 slogan, one of them, because he changed it, like, was, I think, steady leadership in times of change. So that was, like, what, six or seven words? I mean, there's others, and Kerry's was equally as bad. It's all about, there's probably somebody in the messaging war room who decided this is what we want to broadcast out there, and we're just going to repeat it a lot, and we're just going to say it a lot and hope it sticks. Fast forward to 2008. I mean, I think you can sum up Barack Obama, hope and change. I mean, I'm sure there were, yes, we can, very simple, one-syllable words, and going with, not necessarily going with the flow in the sense of being a chameleon and following and being part of the herd, but recognizing that messaging now, overall messaging, not just online messaging, needs to be very simple and gut, and it needs to kind of capture that gut feeling that already to some extent exists and is percolating out there, because an online tools are a critical component of listening to that audience.
So one other thing, you know, it's important to have a message that works, but in this day and age, one of the keys is going to be who's your messenger. And at this stage of the game, you know, up to now, campaigns generally thought in terms of, you know, there's the candidate, and then there are key spokespeople for the campaign, maybe a few endorsers or you know, politicians out there that are campaigning with them. But now I think the key thing is, not only do you have to have a good message, but you have to get the right people to share that message. And the right people are your friends, your peers, people like yourself, people you trust with day-to-day stuff. So a campaign that's able to take two campaigns with the same message, and one's able to get an army of ordinary people out there talking to their friends and being the messengers with that message to them, that message will be more effective and will be stickier in that audience than if it's simply coming from the campaign. People generally trust people more than they trust institutions, and campaigns are institutions. And people trust their peers, their people like themselves, as much as those institutions or more.
I'd like to add one thing to the sort of original idea of how do you cut through the clutter and try to control a message in a modern digital messaging environment. And I agree that it is not to control it, but I do think there are some things you can do to influence it, particularly if you think about it as a conversation, think about it almost like party planning a dinner party. If you bring the right people to a party, they'll have fun without you. You can go cook in the kitchen, you can, you know, go deal with your kids, you can go do whatever, and the party will continue to work just fine. If you bring the wrong mixture of people to the party, no amount of party planning and being attentive will make sure that people have the right conversations and get, you know, continue to talk and stay the entire length of the party as opposed to leaving really quickly. And to some extent, while it's harder for you to, you can't plan a party and say, here's what people will discuss at the party, you can plan a party list, and the discussion will sort of develop along somewhat predictable lines, or at least predictable as these people aren't going to hate each other. These people are going to continue to talk for hours and hours and hours and hours. And sometimes, you know, especially in the political context, it's good to include a rabble-rouser or two. I'll give you an example for a Democratic. I work on the left. One of the things we always do is for our clients, say, fan pages, we'll intentionally, you know, you would think you would go out there and you get a bunch of Democrats as fans, right? Well, you want to do that, of course, but you also want to get a couple of crazy Republicans, not just Republicans, but crazy Republicans,
right.
who will say all sorts of crazy things all the time that upset the Democrats and cause for, you know, if you have five crazy Republicans among 50,000 Democrats, you know, they'll say something crazy, and then a slew of Democratic, like, objections come in. And so it's a very noisy Democratic party talking about how important it is that, you know, whatever. And that happens without you there, because there's somebody in that room saying something that causes everyone else to jump in. And so I do think there are things you can do to control it, but you have to you have to think about it differently. It's as much about the who as it is the what.
You know, it's funny. There's a new community that the RNC has been inviting people to, and I joined it to be the rabble rouser, and nobody's responding to anything I say. It's like, does it only work when the rabble rouser is from the far right?
I've never tried it in reverse.
We'll
they might have they might have that feature that blocks you without you knowing it.
Oh,
yeah.
I came up with that one a long time ago.
So, I think we you know, discussed about messaging, but I guess, you know, tools are really important. Like, you know, we've seen, like, you know, tools have grown and in multitudes. Like, how does one keep up with the tools? Or how do you know which tools are more important to use and which tools are not? Like, how does one make that decision?
Hire professionals.
Yeah, hire us. Yeah. First, I found $5 on my way to the bathroom before. So if it's anybody's, you can claim it. Otherwise, I'll ask a question. Whoever gets it right can get $5. Did anyone lose $5 in the hallway? Come on, someone has, pretend. Okay, so in 2010, there were 100, this was in the Times yesterday, 150,000 applications, or today, built on the Twitter platform. How many applications are there today? 1 million. Who said that? Get your $5. And that's the point. The point is that there really are very few tools. Buy drinks for everybody in here later. Yeah.
Only if the dollar goes far.
Yes. There are very few tools that have tremendous penetration. I mean, we know the web, we know YouTube, we often say Flickr, but I'm not really sure. It's like, and Flickr, don't forget Flickr. Facebook, of course, and Twitter, I mentioned Twitter earlier. And there are a few emerging platforms, probably like Foursquare, Tumblr, what was that? Google Plus, totally. Who are all these weird people who keep following me on Google Plus? All I've done on Google Plus is change my profile photo, and I have like 37 people. Nice to you meet. Who are you? Who, like, seriously, who are you? But, and I think if you look back at 2008, Barack Obama, how many social media platforms did he have a profile on that were listed on the site? Like a good 30.
Yeah.
And that was then. I think there's been some consolidation. You know, Ning is not as important as a platform as it was. But to a certain extent, I think you have to focus on the big platforms and don't get distracted by the small platforms. If you're a presidential candidate and you got 50 people on your internet team and someone says how important some platform is, you can go and play there. But for the most part, for most candidates, stick to the basics. Stick to YouTube, stick to Facebook, stick to Twitter. And, you know, truthfully, Google Plus, maybe, but I think the application deadline was yesterday to apply to actually be a group or a corporation instead of in beta instead of an individual. So I don't even know if that's going to be.
They're going to wipe all those accounts anyway.
I think, like, integration is key. So, I mean, in the past, sort of like a lot of the decision making, particularly if you're dealing, the more technical you get on a campaign, a lot of the decision making is, how are we going to tie all of our data together and all of our different platforms? You know, we got an email vendor here, we've got a database that houses our donor data here, we've got a voter file here. How do we tie all that stuff together? And there's sort of a more and more online, there's sort of the emerging answer. There's this thing called an API, which allows these programs to all talk to one another and seamlessly kind of transfer data, or more or less seamlessly. Let's sort of be kind of realistic about it. And a lot of the same stuff is happening with social networks. So I don't think you purely, sorry, Katie, but I don't think you purely want to rely on Facebook for your campaign. Not that you would say that.
No, you need to integrate it with your website. Yeah. But continue.
Not that you, right. But that's exactly what I'm going to say next. So the connect button, I think, is there for a reason, that you can, instead of trying to build like your internal social network, your Ning network, your maybe even mybarackobama.com if you're kind of a statewide candidate, you can use Facebook Connect to embed kind of social features within an existing application that is tailor-made and specific to your campaign. If you want people to make phone calls into swing states, if you want to do those kinds of things that you can't do on Facebook exclusively, but you want some sort of, hey, I want all my friends to see this. I want to get points or badges for doing cool stuff, and I want all my Facebook friends and my Twitter followers to be aware of that. You can use these APIs from Twitter, from Facebook, to allow people to log in from those applications. It also gets you a lot more users. So, you know, people don't have to fill out this long form and give you your email address to sign up. They can just use what they're comfortable with, and you can get a lot more people and a lot more usage out of your application. So I think that's sort of the emerging standard, as opposed to going out to 20 social networks, is how do I bring the social networks onto my site?
The only thing I would add is, while we all are very smart and we wish that you would hire us, you know, to do your social media, the fact of the matter is, too, is if you're just a starting campaign and you don't have a lot of money, there are a lot of tools out there where you can create a very robust online experience if you just put a little elbow grease into it. So use WordPress for your website, where there's a lot of plugins that will integrate with Twitter and Facebook and social networking sites. Create a Twitter account, create a Facebook page, add some tabs to that, and very quickly you can have an online experience and an integrated one that didn't cost you a lot of money, where, you know, you didn't have to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars building up your website right away. And it can help you get started, so then down the line you can keep building on the tools. You don't have to do everything right away.
So the tools that we've been talking about so far are, you know, do we want to use this social network platform, this social media tool? They're all about tools for connecting with people, but there's a whole other set of tools for measuring how effective you're doing, and those are also very important tools, and there are a whole bunch of them. Because all these social network and social media platforms have open APIs, lots of people have been able to create tools like Clout or Twittleizer, or It's Trending, or all these different tools that people you're reaching, what kind of retweet numbers you're getting, and all these things. And there are a variety of different tools that do it. Some better than others. Some get really good and then Twitter buys them and destroys them. Some get really, really good and then Google buys them and makes them, I don't know. But there's always something new out there. So, you know, anytime you want, you can Google Twitter tools or Facebook tools, and you're always going to find dozens of articles that say 20 essential tools, 10 essential tools, 12. They can't settle on the right number, but there's always a list of this, and just check those out. They're really amazing, and you can find some incredible tools, and you might find one that does what you want it to do, and you just keep using it, and then maybe eventually you'll find something else that's better. But so what if you don't, because this one does the job the way you want it to do? But you want to be able to use these to understand not just how large your audience is, but what quality is your audience? Are they people who live in your who live in the district of the candidate? Are they people who you know, are on your side, likely to vote for you in the general election? Those kinds of things. So you need to know about the size and quality of your audience. You need to know about the level of engagement. To what degree are you actually getting traction in your audience, and are they talking to other people on your behalf? You need to be able to measure that, and you need to be able to understand, you know, what's, even though it may be a small percentage of it, how many of them are coming back and signing up for your email list and signing up and coming to your website. When you have an understanding of those things, then you can start to monitor them on a day-to-day basis and learn, well, what I did today seemed to work really well, what I did yesterday not so much, and so I'll do more of what I did today and less of what I did yesterday. And that's really, really important as you move forward. And so just keep an eye out for these tools and use the ones that you find that are good, and just keep an open eye towards the ones that may emerge that are better.
How is online communication starting to track that, use that? How do you see that being used in this campaign? Because in field, I was a field organizer a little while ago. And so, you know, when you knock on a door, it's a more impactful than when you call on the phone, which is more impactful than getting an email. So you have all these online experiences and barriers for entry that are harder to get through. But they're becoming also easier. Like Facebook Connect is making it easier to sign up for an email list. So I guess, how is that being tracked as well?
That for us, I mean, even way back in 04, that was sort of the whole thesis of our effort and our campaign, was how do we build tools that enable people to connect offline? So whether it was building a house party tool that eventually got 500,000 people out to house parties, where we then did further offline contact, sent postcards, like, here we send them a whole bunch of 500 postcards pre-addressed. Can you lick the envelopes? And further kind of expanded that. Can we go and use these parties to make phone calls to go maybe go knock on doors or do things like that. And that was the whole kind of concept. You know, before Twitter, there's actually this really cool feature that if you went to georgewbush.com from a swing state and from a swing county, we would actually manually, and it was like painstaking labor, we would take a little snippet in the top right corner of the site, because eye tracking studies had shown that that was the spot most likely to get populated, and we would put a little character. There's a phone bank tonight at the Cleveland Victory Center. You should come out. And a lot of people from that, you know, it was sort of using the device as sort the website as a device to capture people and suck them into the offline campaign.
I would also say that the past couple elections have been the first where you started to see online getting its own polling budgets and starting to do its own standalone polling. It's still not happening as much as you would need it to, and it's more becoming sort of accepted articles of faith that the online is working if it's being executed well. And then it's just a matter of measuring the watermarks, not measuring a constant track. I mean, at the end of the day, the piece of offline that most campaigns care about, beyond organizing volunteers, knocking doors, is did they vote for you or not? Or did your people show up? Did the other people stay home? Like, those are the offline actions that campaigns have been measuring for the longest. And those have always been measured through polling, and I believe will continue to be so, even in the online era.
One thing we tried to do in the Rudy campaign but didn't really have enough time to execute was also giving people points and keeping track of what they did offline as well as online in a spot on the web that they could keep track of, and it would help them just the gaming features of it and wanting to compete and be on that leaderboard helped integrate both what you were asking them to do offline as well as online.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Young. I'm a student at Georgetown's Communication, Culture, and Technology program. It's been a really interesting event. I'm really happy to be here. I wanted to ask, in terms of the targeting kind of campaign that you all were speaking of, do you worry about the use of cookies having a backlash from privacy advocates? And as you use more targeting campaigning, do you worry about missing the middle or those who would not engage originally? Thank you.
Can I take on cookies? Okay, so cookies are really amazing. They're freakishly amazing. Okay, so for example, we can run 3 ads online, all on CNN.com in the politics section in 3 different shapes and sizes. And I could serve those ads just to you guys, and you'd see all different permutations of the ads based on who you are and where you live and what your behaviors are. And then I could tell you, say you clicked on the ad, but you didn't do anything on the website. You just came to the website. But 3 days later, you come back to the website and you make a donation. I tie your donation back to the exact ad you saw on the exact day you saw it, the exact time you saw it, and which ad size you saw it, and which section of the website you saw it, and on which website. So cookies are freakishly powerful when you think about that. There's a project I'm working on right now where we're actually taking 300 million offline records as part of a voter file and building cookie pools online based on that. So we'll actually be able to target online. And the Republicans do this with a company called Campaign Grid. But for Democrats, it'll be the first time they're able to target online based on Democrats who didn't vote in the last election cycle, but vote in the cycle before that, who live here, who do this, who have 3 children and drive this and do that across the entire internet. UCL be able to do a list match with just AOL or just Yahoo. Now you can do it across the whole internet. So like, it's getting freakishly amazing from a targeting standpoint. The one thing I worry about is backlash, because for almost all candidates, for almost all legislation about advertising, about messaging, political candidates exclude themselves from regulation. So political candidates are not governed by canned spam. Political candidates can spam you all day long because it's political speech. It's protected speech. It's the most highly protected speech under the First Amendment. So you're going to come to this point where candidates are saying, or elected officials. You can't do this, corporation. You can't do this. But then they're going to be using it in their campaigns. So I am worried about a backlash at a certain point. I think, I don't know, 2, 3, 4 years from now, probably 2 years from now, we'll have something else. I've seen a lot of browser extensions that emulate the behavior of a cookie. And I've also seen cookies that don't sit on the browser but sit on the computer. The former roadie and manager from InXS started a website, a company called Blue Kava. And you can read the whole story, but they're trying to create like the next version of the cookie. But ultimately, it's a really powerful, exciting tool. And we can't use it, I'm going to keep on using it.
I would also say that the backlash would be misplaced. It's definitely going to happen because privacy advocates always freak out when online targeting gets better. But it will be misplaced. None of what he said is new. It's been done by the male people for 35 years. The only difference is you had to kill a lot of trees to do that kind of targeting in the past. What it's doing is it's making internet finally powerful enough to start replacing these other mediums wholesale. And I think that the biggest threat to the medium will come from the people who are financially interested in preventing online from capturing the budget share, not from privacy activists.
So I'm thinking of cookie pools, and all I can see is big vats of chocolate chip cookies and people swimming in them. And I'm not sure if it's a good thing or a bad thing. But
is that a bad thing? What is bad about that?
If you're diabetic, it's bad.
Sure.
But the other thing to consider here is that there's kind of a generational gap going on here in terms of privacy issues. Younger generations don't care about privacy the same way older generations do. Yeah, everybody cares about privacy in some way or another, but it's qualitatively different. And so I don't think you can use the reactions of the privacy activists, who I think tend to be older generation, as to a predictor for how it's going to play out in future years, because it's just a whole different group of people. How many of you here put personal information online?
How many don't?
How many don't? How many of you differentiate between personal and private? How many of you don't differentiate between personal and private? So I just think that, I think that there's differences going on here. What your parents and grandparents think is private, you may just think is personal, but okay to share. And because, you know, everybody's doing that. The whole idea of, you know, don't put photos of you drinking on Facebook because employers won't hire you. Eventually, those employers will all die. And you'll be the ones hiring them.
They'll be dead. Where are your pictures of drinking?
I guess I was going to ask about attribution, but also as a quick follow-up to that, I'm curious if you see any of the candidates adopting Evidon, and then also whether or not you'll see more research being done on the attribution side on the political realm to see if the whole last-click mentality kind of evaporates on that end as well.
What do you mean by attribution?
So one of the companies that's out there right now is C3, and they've been going around a lot of these tech conferences and whatnot. And the idea is that we only really measure effectively the last click, and that tends to be what gets the credit, even with cooking and heat mapping and whatnot. And so the idea is C3 and some of these other companies are out there, and they give weighted to the originator, which is the first area where you view, and then you get a sys. So if I see a display banner, that's the original. If it appears above the fold and in my sight lines, and then I go to the website and scroll down halfway, that could be an assist, but I don't do it and I go somewhere else, that could be an assist. And then I do a search and I click and then I actually do the consideration piece of it. That would be the finalizer. So it's the idea of showing weighted engagement to see where maybe money should be invested throughout the process. So there's that. And then the Evidon question as well.
In terms of Evidon, I don't think any political candidate should do drugs. I think that's terrible. What's Evidon?
Yeah, never heard of it.
So I'll say quick answer, and I don't know why I'm talking so much. I think maybe it's all the alcohol, all the stuff. The Red Bull. Wings. I honestly think that if political candidates didn't exist for finite periods of time, they probably would do more targeting and more attribution based on last click. But you have to keep in mind that elections are finite events, and probably close to 60% or more, maybe 70% of all advertising budgets are spent in the last 6 or 7 weeks of a political campaign. So attribution becomes much less important because we're not really in the end of it in a direct response business as much as a persuasion business. So we're not as concerned about where is the most efficient use of my money. Efficiency is not something that we care about in politics. We don't care about diminishing marginal returns of television. We buy as much as possible. We spend as much as possible. And if there's a dollar left in our bank account on the day after election day, then we did something wrong. So we don't think of how do we spend efficiently. We think of can we raise as much money as possible so we could spend as much of it everywhere.
And the other thing is, you remember, in politics, it's about repetition. You know, and not just, and these days, I think not just about the message being repeated, but being repeated through multiple sources. Mm-hmm. Source amnesia, which Josh likes to talk about a lot. And but the idea is that, you know, when you hear things 3, 5, 6, 10 times, you're more likely to remember it. If you hear it from multiple different sources, I think it's even stickier. So yeah. This idea of attribution in the context of these elections doesn't make as much sense because you want people to hear it from all different sides, and you wouldn't take one of those away because it wasn't performing as well because it's part of the larger mix.
That's exactly right.
And Evidon, you know those little blue triangles in the corner of your ad that you can click to then opt out? Evidon's a provider of that.
Oh, yeah. So when it comes to anything opt in or opt out, you're not going to talk. We're not talking about a significant portion of anyone.
Well, it's 1% of 1% of the people who are actually opting out. I was just curious to get away from some of the backlash, because that's really what it is.
But
you have
Google's
like Turn.com telling you have to do it now, but no one's really...
But that's what it is. Like, Google and Turn include the ability to opt out of targeting in their ad units.
And no one does it.
It's automatic. But a lot of candidates are getting press attention for, like, they're letting people opt out of targeting, when it really has nothing to do with them. It's just that's the technology.
Yeah, it's a great PR play lately.
Yeah. Romney did that.
I started studying campaigns on the internet back in 1998 in a PhD program at American University. And back then there was like, I would show up at events at the National Press Club and there'd be the same five panelists. One of them, I think you probably worked with Mike Connell.
Sure, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I was studying particularly House races and it was all kinds of interesting stuff. And then I studied them in 2000. It got less interesting, and they started to all look pretty similar. And by 2002, it was almost not looking worth looking at because all of the sites looked exactly the same. It looked like they were done by the exact same people.
And they were.
What I wonder if now I hear you talking about all the different tools, and but very little about the websites themselves. Is that because the sites themselves have become uninteresting?
Yes. No, it's people are lazy somewhat. Everybody wants to. There's a reason almost every single website after the 08 election looked like BarackObama.com. Because every race wanted to copy. They're like, oh, that worked for them. That made them win. We're going to copy everything down to the colors and font and site layout. Go ahead.
I think that's true. That's absolutely true. Gotham became the coolest font in America after Barack Obama. But, I mean, on the other hand, like, from a layout standpoint and what pages are there and the basic functionality, like, there's a right way to do it. And what happened is people figured out the right way to do it. And anyone who veers from that path is doing it wrong at some level. Like, if you don't put your email sign up above the fold on every single page, you're doing it wrong, period. If you don't put, you know, if you don't take advantage of the top right-hand corner of the content area and put your most important, whatever it is for your priorities there, you are doing it wrong. And there is no ifs, ands, or buts about it. So some part of it is I do think people figured out the right way to do it. And I think a lot of the changes that are happening between these sites now are changes you would never see. It's changes that you don't realize that they're split testing 15 versions of that button versus one version of that button. Where the button is going to be is not going to change anymore. But what it says, you know, what they're cooking about you and how that's extending to the ads that you see elsewhere, that is changing dramatically. But it's all happening on layers that the average casual observer would never see.
Well, I mean, that's definitely happening on some campaigns, but it's not happening happening on a lot. And I guess from one of the frustrations I have is Josh is absolutely right. There's right ways to do it and there's wrong ways to do it. But one of the things the Obama campaign did right is they were testing different things, and they were finding the new layouts that worked better. You know, one thing's the donation page. Most everybody always wanted to have the text on top across two columns, then you had a two-column form underneath. The Barack Obama campaign, which I admittedly copied from with the NRSC, is just testing a straight two-column donation form. And you know what? It works better. And, you know, we tested a bunch of different stuff, and they led the way, and I just feel like too many campaigns are scared to be the ones that lead the way and test, and they would rather just try and follow what's only worked before them and not also try new stuff as well.
The more prominence that the online campaign has had, particularly at the lower levels, I mean, the more uninteresting and commoditized it seems to get, whereas people say, I mean, it used to be if you could build a really good-looking website, you know, you probably had a pretty good business and you had a select group of people who were willing to pay for that. Now, everyone can design a good website. Everybody can code in WordPress. Everybody can do it. And as a result, it's become easier and more democratized. It's easier to get going. But the result can oftentimes be, if there's not this commitment to metrics and to testing and to even principles of good design that, you know, even exist in direct mail, you know, and that if there's not that commitment, it's mediocrity.
The biggest issue is that it's not profitable for us to build really great websites. Yeah. That's really what it comes down to. There's a finite amount of money that you're willing to spend on a website because there are only 5 people on the Democratic side who build political candidate websites, and you could email all of them and say, how much does it cost to build a candidate website? Well, what are you running for? Senate, huh? Do you have a lot of money? I have some money. Okay, it's this much. And then all 5 of them bid against each other, and they said, this one's giving me this, and this one's giving this. It is called a race to the bottom, and that's what's happening. So when someone only wants to spend 10 grand, 20 grand, 30 grand, 40 grand on a website, well, you're going to get the same back-end system as everyone else, the same tool set as everybody else, and you're going to get the one designer who works at the place to create your design. And they're going to say, do you have colors? Oh, you like red. Okay, we'll make it redder than the other guy's site. But that's it. That's it. And it's not because we're not creative people, because we're creative in almost everything else we do. It's just because they're not willing to spend the money. So how am I going to hire someone who's a user experience, a user interaction designer, a front-end designer versus a back-end designer, like a coder who understands, you know, it's like, it's just, there's no money in it.
It's true. Well, I love my own communication shop now, and I have experienced that aspect of it. It's often not worth it. That if they have their cousin Vinny who can do it for a few bucks, he can do the same thing that I would do for him.
Or by the boilerplate plug and play, you know, this is a nonprofit website template.
Right.
Yeah. And they work. And they're good. Yeah. They work. They don't go down. They all, you want to sign up for something, you sign up for something. They all work. I mean, like, we've gotten to the point where we've scaled it and it looks good and they work. So,
Well, it was like, remember, and even a lot of this creativity is shifting to what kind of campaign, online campaign or fundraising effort am I going to do? So remember when the money bomb was. Mm. You know, totally innovate. I mean, it was like absolutely groundbreaking and revolutionary. And that Ron Paul, like this obscure congressman from Texas, like this total crank, could raise $6 million in a single day. And as a result, you know, every single state rep, congressional candidate last cycle, it was a money bomb, except, well, you know, we want to make our numbers look good, so we'll stretch it out over 5 or 6 days. We're not going to necessarily make it on a single day. You know, they're going to be for, like, instead of $5 million, we're going to raise $5,000, and that's going to look cool somehow. And it doesn't, and now nobody wants to talk about money bombs anymore. So we see that kind of the venue for creativity is very much of a moving target, and it shifts. And this, I wonder what it's going to be in 12. I still don't know yet.
Yeah. When you start to look at the the bigger picture then, you know, in this context, you know, the websites become sort of standard pro forma. They all have the same functionality. There's a good way to do it. There's a bad way to do it. They get a little boring. This is true. But I think we need to think in terms of, you know, what's your web strategy? And we need to get people thinking way beyond the idea that my web strategy is about what my website looks like and does and what my emails say and look like and who I send them to. It's about your social media strategy. It's about your fundraising strategy, about your online to offline conversions, it's about your advertising. When you think in terms of your web strategy, you need to think about what's my strategy across the entire web. And now the web, you know, even more than the web, but you know, digital networks. And now we're talking mobile, we're talking video games, we're talking websites, we're talking social media, we're talking phone applications, all of this stuff. How does it all work together? How does it integrate with each other? And how does it integrate with the rest of the campaign? And that when you get to that level of thinking and that level of implementation, now you're in a whole nother ball game, and it doesn't really matter, you know, and the website becomes only a small cog in that wheel.
I'd love to ask some highfalutin question about what you're doing with APIs, but I am so perplexed by the money and attention that telephone poles get when everyone has caller ID and most people in here don't have a landline. And, you know, people just selectively pick it up and say, I know who that's a pole, and I'm going to pick it up and mess with them or push my point with them, and that's the only reason I do it.
Right.
Yeah, that must drive you guys nuts, too, but just... If you could explain why they still do that, I'd be very grateful. All
right. So online polls have been, or polls in general, yeah, telephone polls in general have been on the verge of being useless for about 10 years now. The response rates on phone polls is something on the order of 12% if you're lucky, which if you're talking about getting a random a probability sample that you can actually make inferences from, it's ridiculous. Unfortunately, for those who are making money off of it, so far it still works. The numbers still come out and are fairly accurate. You'll see that they tend to work. But everybody is preparing for the reality that because it's such at the margin in terms of response rates, overnight it could stop working. And so they've been working on a lot of strategies for alternative ways of generating representative samples in order to get stuff. And as Josh mentioned, a lot of people are starting to use just Facebook ads as a way to, as an alternative and much cheaper alternative to doing polls.
They're still the fastest and best way to get 200 people to answer 50 long questions. And as long as you are consistent, they're very helpful. So, for example, if I do a phone poll today, I'm not doing anything today, and then I go out in the middle of the street and I start bashing car windows and doing crazy stuff and scream something crazy, and then tomorrow you do another phone poll and say, have you heard of this guy who's on the street? You know, as long as you're being consistent in your methodology, it's a good way to measure lift.
At some point, you're going to get a candidate that no one realized everyone under 35 was voting for, and you polled and you missed everybody under 35 who doesn't have a landline.
Well, that's what happened in New Hampshire in the primaries to some degree.
Well, the other thing is that public polling has gotten worse while internal campaign polling hasn't. There's, I think, a pressure for public pollsters.
Josh,
to,
can you talk into the
yeah,
microphone?
I think there's a pressure for public pollsters to put out a lot more numbers more often. And, I mean, there were certain states like Rasmussen in Nevada last year was just a joke. Like, Rasmussen shouldn't even be a pollster anymore after those numbers. But it was because they had to put out so many numbers in so many states that their model in Nevada was garbage. And they were great in a couple other states. Not most states, but, you know, they got it right in a couple
places. Rasmussen is a bad example. They intentionally skew their polls.
Sure. But the point is the internal polls we're seeing tend to be spot on. But that's because those pollsters are given much larger budgets to run much larger samples. Many of them are doing cell phone polling as well with live callers.
And many of them are also doing online panels.
Yep.
And they'll do online panels and they'll measure them how they do against the phone poll. And if they're significantly similar, they'll ditch the phone and do more online. They'll still charge $100,000 for the polls. They'll just do three of them instead of one of them. So there's not like a reluctance There really isn't. The company I worked at before, Burson-Marsteller Global Strategy Group, is first and foremost a pollster. Burson-Marsteller is now run by Mark Penn from Penn from Berlin, PSB, who was Hillary Clinton's pollster and the firms I've worked on really rely on research, and they really, I assure you, don't care about phones. They're not sitting there like, it's got to be the phone. It's not like the TV media consultants who we face who are like, ha ha ha, internet. The researchers, they legitimately want to have the best research, because if you have the best research, you'll get hired again. If you predict who's going to win within 2 points, you'll remember that, because they'll go back and show the next client, look how close we predicted the actual outcome. So they're not, you know, they're not beholden to phones.
Thank you.
Hi, I'd like to get into a smaller universe, local races. Especially appropriate tools to use. I have a candidate who hasn't used Twitter and wants to use Twitter. I certainly want to do some listening groups. She calls them meet and greets. And then I want to talk about getting to young urban Latinos and African Americans.
To plug my current employer and the one that pays my paychecks, Facebook advertising can be a good way to localize advertising in a cost-effective manner to initially get awareness about your candidate out in those areas, and especially if you're doing like those meet and greets you mentioned. Put an event on Facebook, run some ads to that event on Facebook in, you know, the city location that your candidate's in, and you, even if you throw $50 to $100 to it, which isn't a lot, you're still gonna, you know, reach some folks and be able to see if that's an effective way of of doing it. And I think that's one thing too, where whether you're using Facebook or Twitter, you're probably not gonna have a lot of followers, but because so many more people, like I mentioned, are getting their news from friends and family, even if you have a small core of 25 people who are helping to share that information within their social networks, that can play a large role in when they go to the ballot box, then they're going to see that name and they may be like, I don't remember where I saw that name, but I saw that name and I recognize it, therefore I'm going to vote for them. Which, I mean, it's not the ideal, but some people vote that way. And that can just be one good way to start getting the ball rolling. And I always like to say too that a lot of the stuff we talk about is after the handshake. You're doing the hard work going out there. Being on social media, having a good website gives people a way to stay engaged after they've met your candidate and keeping them engaged until election day.
So these like local elections, I mean, I think $1 billion goes to the person who can figure out a way to do local elections well on the internet and scale it, because that is, I mean, that's actually like the experiences. I think that's where the internet can make the most difference, honestly, because I mean, if you're talking about anything in a national election or a statewide election is going to make a difference by 2 or 3 points, and oftentimes that can make a big difference. Like, I think that strategy and tactics can make a huge difference, particularly in a local election. Maybe there's not a lot of voter turnout. There was this fascinating sort of pseudo study that came out last year that they folks kind of did a study of just what a simple email to a group of friends could do in a contested primary, I think for attorney general in New York, and just asking them to vote for a particular candidate in the primary when frankly nobody cared, and then they check back and see who voted for that candidate. And it was a surprising number. Now, the question is, can you get enough people to do that where it makes a difference? Can you get enough people to, say, spread the word on in their Facebook stream? And those are all people in a hefty chunk of those, a large percentage of those people will be people in that specific neighborhood. If you can set a challenge, I want 50 people, it doesn't sound like a lot, to post on Facebook about me. That seems like a good micro challenge, and you maybe have like, you know, one of those thermometer progress bars, and you kind of apply those urgency dynamics to it. You can actually get that, but each of those 50 people might have 500 friends, and you've just reached 25,000 people very inexpensively. So I think that that is the arena where potentially if you're thinking about, I want 10,000 followers, that's the wrong way to think about it, is how do I find the most energized core of people and build out from there?
Also, there's been a rule of thumb, and you know, Katie, I don't, you might have real data to back this up, but the rule of thumb that I've often heard is that people's Facebook friends are 80% local, 20% national, and Twitter friends tend to be 20% local, 80% national, and that's sort of the general thing, which means that for local elections, Facebook seems to lend itself naturally to it. But that's looking at the average. Twitter, if you are fixated and focused on building a local following on Twitter and you spend your time at the events where you're meeting voters in the district and influencers and press in the district and reaching them through phone, face-to-face, email, any way you can, and you get them to follow you on Twitter, knowing that this is a way for you to connect with us, you could build a list of even just a few hundred local influencers in your in the jurisdiction of the race, and not have to worry about how many other followers you have, because you're going to be able to use Twitter to get to them in a timely fashion. And if they're reporters, they're going to get information and write about it. If they're bloggers, they're going to get information and post about it. If they're business leaders, they're going to be talking about it at their business club meetings. Rotary, Kiwanis, all that kind of stuff, if they still exist. Or water cooler conversations. I mean, the idea is to figure out who people are listening to, who's talking to who in the jurisdiction, and just go and say, hey, we have a Twitter account. Talk to them, because it's local, right? We have a Twitter account, and it's a great way for you to figure out what we're doing with the campaign as it happens. Now, you have to be using Twitter to do that and use it effectively, so that you have to pay close attention to what you put out on it in terms of what information you're giving people. But if you're putting out good information that people can use in a timely fashion, and you make sure the right people are following you, you can make a great impact with a small number of people in your audience.
I'd like to, do you mind if I answer this one as well? Here's the 30-second how you win a small election online. Put very little effort into organic. Follow your entire press list on Twitter. That's it on Twitter. If you let your candidate tweet, they better not be a drunk. I'm serious. Don't let them get anywhere near social media if they are. Have someone else has to ghost for them. Facebook, use physical, like when people come to your office to volunteer, force them to sit down at a computer and invite people to be a fan of your page. You do that with like four or five good nights of volunteering, you have a much bigger Facebook presence than anyone. I also agree with her about Facebook ads. Facebook's primary purpose to you is going to be advertising, and in fact, the internet's primary purpose to you is going to be paid communications. If you can afford to run TV, you only need to spend about 10 to 15% of your online budget or your total media budget online. If you can afford to run cable but not broadcast, it needs to be more like 25 to 30%. And if you're going to be doing a mail robocall race, it should be 40 to 50% of your budget should be going to online paid media. Stay away from local newspapers. They're too expensive. All that money should be going through Google and Facebook.
Would you be surprised to learn that 25% of the people who use Twitter are African American?
No, I'm not. Yeah.
You can language target as well on Facebook.
Yeah. For Hispanic, language targeting is great. Twitter tends to be much better than you would expect for reaching African American audiences. Again, you need to focus. You know, Facebook doesn't let you target by race because they don't even ask people what their race is, so it's just not even a field. This is where going face to face and getting people to sign up on Facebook and on Twitter, in your presence, this is going to make a big difference. You don't need that many, right? You know, you're going to be meeting the people who are most engaged, which means that they're the ones who are going to be turning around and talking to their friends in their neighborhoods and their family. And so those are the ones that you want on your list following you anyway. So just ask them.
SMS is powerful. It's a little expensive to get up and running. It costs a few $1,000s, but text messages, I really like text messages, especially if you have a candidate who's an incumbent or someone who's going to run again or for an organization, because while you might change your email address every few years, I change jobs all the time. Your email address changes. My cell phone number hasn't changed since I graduated college. So
It's a good way to keep in touch with people over time, and it's all opt-in, so it's a really close-knit group. So I like SMS as well. And there are some less expensive SMS options.
Oh, and your email list is your candidate's Rolodex. That's where you raise all your money. And they need to call through it before they solicit online.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much.